Respected Chairman Sir and distinguished delegates, a very good morning to all of you. On the onset, I would like to first of all thank the organizing committee for giving me this opportunity to speak before such an august gathering. Today I shall be speaking on wood culture in India and particularly from wood anatomy aspect. The ancient civilization of India can be traced back to 5,000 years, and the written information on wood can be traced back to 2,500 years. We have ancient literature like Vedas, Upanishads and Purans, and also we have religious texts in the form of Ramayana and Mahabharata, which dates back to 2,500 years back. In India, the exploration started in 1784 by Asiatic Society. This got impetus by the establishment of this Archaeological Survey of India in 1861. And this particular organization basically did excavations in India and helped us in throwing light on the wood culture during the last 5,000 years. In India, Forest Research Institute, Dehradun, has been carrying out wood anatomy research since past 100 years. And besides FRI, some sister organizations and universities are also working in this field. Now, we have been rendering wood identification services to the entire nation, including departments like Defense, CBI, Anti-Corruption Bureaus, National Test Houses, Railways, Housing Corporations, Sports Authority of India, Electricity Boards, Forest Departments, and of course, Archaeological Survey of India. And also, the fossil woods are identified for Birbal Sahani Institute of Paleobotany. And also, we do identification for handicraft departments. In today's presentation, I shall be concentrating on wood culture that might have been existing in prehistoric and historic India, as evident from the various excavations carried out by Archaeological Survey of India and wood identification being carried out by Forest Research Institute. Now in India, most of the religious and our domestic architecture from its very inception has been wood-based. And the tradition of wood carvings is very old, but due to perishable nature of wood, we do not have much of the ancient works, and they have almost perished. So, and there's a general saying that whatever stone carving we have in India today are basically the replica of wooden carvings that existed much before switching to stone. Now in today's presentation, I shall be concentrating on the excavations carried out at certain places like Burjahome, which is in northern India, northmost part of India, in Kashmir. Then Harappa, now this particular place is in Pakistan. Rampur, Lothal, this is the port city. Prakash, Maski, Arik Meru, Patliputr, Hastinapur, and Jagatgram. Coming to the first site, which is a Neolithic site and dates back to 2375 to 1535 BC. This is a place called Burjahome in Kashmir, and the burnt materials from this particular area were identified as Parisiopsis jacimontiana, Prunus, Juniperus, and one monocot. This particular species, Parisiopsis, twigs are still used as wicker work and Prunus flakes as for mud plastering in this part of India. Now coming to the next site, which is a Bronze Age site and dates back to 2500 to 1750 BC, And this was a time when this Indus Valley civilization was in full bloom. We all know that India is among the earliest civilizations of the world, just like Egypt, Mesopotamia, and China. The knowledge about the civilization of this particular time, Indus Valley civilization, comes from the study of excavations made at Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, which are now in Pakistan, and then Lothal, Rangpur. These are the names of the places which are now in India. I shall be taking few of them one by one. Coming to the first site, which is a Bronze Age site dating back to 2500 to 2000 BC. This is called Harappa, and wood remains of a very highly deteriorated coffin was brought to us for identification, and they were found to be made up of Citrus devdara and Delbergia latifolia. Delbergia latifolia is rosewood. So this indicates that Harappans were first of all very well acquainted with the use of durable and scented woods, and secondly it shows that they used to have trade connections with the northern part, because this particular species Citrus devdara comes from a very very high it's a high Himalayan plant, and they're talking of a place which is based at this place. So they showed that people of these two places were having trade connections, and also the civilization existed in the northern India also. This is just a photograph of that coffin, and this is how it was brought to us, very very small wood fragments in mud from which the identification was carried out. Another timber that was found in this particular area was gypsum, and it was supposed to be a mortar for pounding grains. Now this is a very interesting find, because today it has been scientifically proved that gypsum has got very good shock absorbing property. The other species that was found in this area was Almus, and the purpose of using this particular species cannot be assigned. Then earlier records also show use of Pinus roxburghii, that is Chir, and Citrus devdara for house building. Now all these above timbers are very well known commercial timbers of present day India. Now coming to the next site, which is Lothal in Gujarat. This place, this dates back to 2350 to 2200 BC, and this is a port town. This is the first tight dock of the world, constructed for berthing and servicing ships. Thus boat building technology in India goes back to the 3rd millennium BC. The wooden artifacts excavated from this particular area were acacia species, and the most interesting find is the presence of Acacia chandra. Then we had Albizia, Edina cordifolia, Tetuna grandis, one Lauraceae wood, and Soemida fabrifuga. This indicates there has not been much climatic change during the last 4,400 years, because most of these species are still occurring in this area. And secondly, the most important find in this particular study was of Acacia chandra, which is one of the best timber for dock works. And it is said that it is a substitute for Lignum vitae of South America, which is Bicum officinal. So it has self-lubrication property basically. So there is no effect of water on this particular wood. It's a marine wood, can be used for dock works. Then coming to the next site, which is Rangpur again in Gujarat, and dates back to 2000 BC. Chart remains identified as Acacia species, Albizia, Pterocarpus centellinus, Soemida fabrifuga, and Tamarix species. Since the wood identified are from charcoal, it is difficult to visualize their uses. Again, these are well-known woods of today also for construction and agriculture implements, so might be they were used for the same purpose during that time. Now this presence of Pterocarpus centellinus is interesting, because now it is found in this particular part of India, while it has been collected from Rangpur in 2000 BC. Now coming to the next age, which is the Iron Age, and this was a time when Aryans got established in India. And this was the most important time because our ancient literature was written during this time. So it is said that Aryans used to live in wooden houses or huts made up of wood. The literature, ancient literature, quotes, I'm just quoting one of the literature, that is the Puranas, and in that there's a quote about the use of the tree or the wood. There should not be any tree in the front of the house, but trees have to be planted towards the back. The wood with which the house has to be built must be carefully chosen, and one must not cut down a tree that birds have built nest on. Certain trees must never be chosen. These include those that have been gashed by an elephant or struck by lightning. They also include trees that grow near temples or at the banks of rivers, and trees on cremation grounds. The neem trees, neem is Azadi Rakta Indica, which is a highly medicinal tree, and mango trees must never be used for building houses. It also says that every home should have a beautifully carved door frame in wood as a sign of welcome to visitors. So that shows that people had a knowledge or go for a wood culture during that particular period. Then coming to some of the sites of those of that particular period, and one of them is Hastinapur, which dates back to 1100 to 800 BC. The wood remains were of Dalbergia, Shishu, this is Shisham, well-known timber of India, then Holeraina, Antidicentrica, one wild cane, and rice. This Holeraina Antidicentrica is a highly medicinal small tree and is well known for its medicinal properties. Then after Aryans came the two great religions of India in 6000 BC, and that was Jainism and Buddhism. Now Jainism is basically famous for their stone architecture, and for Buddhism we are still in the process of doing work in collaboration with Archaeological Survey of India, so I won't be touching this particular part much today. Then we had Mauryas from 500 to 300 BC, and this was the time when Alexander was there in India. It is said that Alexander's huge fleet had 2,000 boats built of Himalayan timber supplied by Indian craftsmen, built entirely of Indian wood and by the hands of Indian craftsmen. All this indicates that in this age of the Mauryas, shipbuilding in India was a regular and flourishing industry of which the outpost was very, very large. Then coming to another site, which is a Chalcolithic site, dates back to between some 1700 BC to 6th century AD. This is a place called Prakash from Maharashtra, and the excavation revealed use of Tectuna grandis, which is teak, acacia, anogyses, Dalbergia latifolia is rosewood, Albizia species, Terminalia, Holoraina antidicentrica, and one bamboo, probably Dendrocalamus. The present flora of this area suggests the dominance of the same species even today. Then the another site of the same period is Muskie near Raichur, and charcoal remains were identified as acacia and chloroxylon sutinia. At present, these timbers are considered to be one of the best woods for charcoal and fuel purposes. So this knowledge goes back to 300 BC. Then coming to another site, Shishupalghar in Odisha, and charred remains were found to be of Acacia, Holoraina antidicentrica, Boswellia serrata, Caesaria species, Soymida fabrifuga, and some bamboos. The above indicated that forest cover of these regions was more or less of the same type as it exists now, and that there has not been any commercial connection also between various areas. Then this was another interesting study that was carried out of one place called Pataliputra, and this was the Ashoka's palace was there, and it was built in 2200. This particular wood which was brought from this palace dates back to 2250 to 350 years old and was identified as Shorya Robusta, which is sal. And this is the most popular timber used for constructional purposes in India. And interestingly, the good state of preservation of this wood, which remained in the ground for over 20 centuries, reflect upon the durability of this timber. So it's a highly durable timber. Now coming to another site, which is a pre-medieval site dating back to 100 to 200 AD. It's called Arakmedu and is in Pondicherry, just the southern tip of India. And the species that were found here were Diospyrus, which is ebony, Mimeosops, and Heritieri. All the three are at present well-known commercial timbers of India, firstly. Diospyrus today is used for ternary and carving purpose, while Mimeosops and Heritieria are strong and very, very durable timbers, which are used for building, construction, and agricultural implements. Then coming to the other find, which is of early historic period and dates back to 2nd century AD, there was a sacrificial pillar which was brought from Kirari, Madhya Pradesh, and this was found to be made of Madhuka latifolia. And this is a timber which is very well known for its strength and durability, and that too durability in contact with soil and water. Then another early historic period which dates back to 3rd century AD, and there is a there was one ancient culture which prevailed in India, and that was related to horse sacrifice. And this was to establish supremacy of a king over all others. So wood remains from one Ashwamedha site was brought and were found to be of Shorya Robusta, Terminalia, Mangifera indica, which is mango, Cinnamomum, which was probably Cinnamomum tamala. Now this Shorya was used for sacrificial stand, which reveals that familiarity was there with its strength property. I just showed that Shorya Robusta is one of the most important constructional timber. So it is a very, very durable and have got lot of strength. So it was used for sacrificial stand. Terminalia was used for boiling blood or the flesh. And this is well-known timber for which is it's an excellent fuel wood and also gives very good charcoal. Then Mangifera was used for lighting home or aroma or fire, and Cinnamomum as a substitute of true cinnamon. The tradition of using Mangifera and cinnamon woods for yagna still prevails in India, and this reflects upon the timeless and immutable Indian customs. Now another site which are well-known Buddhist caves, and this is from Maharashtra dating back to 2nd to 3rd century BC. The ceilings of Tectuna Grandis was found in one of the caves, and this dates back to 2200 years. These Tectuna Grandis beams, they were found to be apparently very sound, but when wood chemistry was carried out, it was found that the cellulose and crystalline nature had considerably reduced in these beams. Then there has been a very, very recent discovery of a submerged city that has been found recently and is supposed to be dating to 5000 to 7000 BC. It's in the it was found in Gulf of Gambia, and there was a big news about this, saying that it's a world oldest city being found. Some wood species were brought to us from this area, and they were found to be of acacia. Then coming to the post-Gupta period, that is after 5th century AD, this particular period had lot of wood culture, and this is very well reflected in our temples, palaces, artifacts, as well as written records. Now, just giving you very, very few examples of wood culture as reflected in the temples and palaces of ancient India. The tradition of wood carving, of course, in India has been from the very ancient time, and it is still surviving in many parts of the India. This is one of the wooden temples found in Himachal Pradesh, that is somewhat northern India, and this dates back to 7th to 11th century. And there are 84 temples like this in this area, all built up of cedrus devdaru. Then we have another temple in the same state that dates back to 1553 AD, and this is a three-tiered roof, again made up of cedrus devdaru. Then we have one of the museum displays this temple chariot, which is made up of Shoria Robusta and Tectuna Grandis, and this dates back to 18th to 19th century AD. Then this is one of the wooden palaces of India, which is in South India. And here we have beams of Tectuna Grandis. Interior carvings are on Delbergia latifolia, that is the rosewood. The ceilings were of Sweetenia mahogany, the mahogany wood of India. And then Artocarpus hatrophilus columns can be seen in this particular palace. Then we have few more palaces that are again built up of wood. One is Malawala Palace, which is in Hyderabad, and this dates back to 1724 and is made up of Tectuna Grandis. The palace has also got a carved roof of Juglans regia, that is the walnut tree. Then there's another palace in Bangalore, which is again totally built of wood, and it has got pillars which are made up of Tectuna Grandis. It is almost made up of Tectuna Grandis. Then this is another palace in India, which is Mysore Palace, and this is one of the biggest palaces of India. This is said that it was originally built in wood and got burned down in 1897, and now of course it has been built in stone. Now coming to the present scenario, India has been a traditional producer of wood carving furniture for ages, and the handicraft people that keep sending us samples for identification of wood, from that we came to know that they use different woods for different purposes. Like if they want to go for deep undercutting and sculptural effect, they'll use Tectuna Grandis, Delbergia latifolia and Juglans regia. If they want low relief work to be done, they'll use Delbergia sisu and Cedrus devdaru. If they want some incised design to be carried out, they'll use Diospyros, which is ebony. Then for coarse Tikoma undulator, then Shoria Robusta, and all these woods basically are coarse grained and hard, so they are used for very, very bold works. Then if they want to have some polychromatic effect, they go for Edina cordifolia, which is a yellow colored wood, totally yellow, and then Holorhina antidicentrica, which is a white wood. So other most common species of wood being used for these purposes are Mangifera indica, Thoon, Azadi Rakta Indica, Shoria's, Syzygium and Tikomelas. Then we have different woods being used for building boats in different states as per the local availability. So the different states, basically they use different woods for boat buildings, etc., because they are locally available to them. So this is also interesting that they could find good local woods for these purposes. So I've listed just few of them over here. I don't think I need to just read all these botanical names. I'm just skipping. Then Indian music has an accumulated heritage of centuries, and the origin can be traced back to the Vedic period, that is the written records one came into, and the woods which are being used in manufacturing the vital parts of these instruments are Tectuna grandis, Delbergia sisu, Tuna ciliata, Delbergia latifolia, Artocarpus heterophyllus, Sutinia species, and also bamboo. Then like many other countries, we also have puppets which are made up of very, very light woods, usually of Mangifera indica and Ascanomyine indica, which is a Shola wood, well known light wood. Then the present scenario now. In India, the demand of woods is much more than the supply. And due to ban on green felling in most of the states and plantation forestry being introduced slightly late, India has to spend a sizable amount on purchase of imported woods. Now there's a shift from solid wood to wood substitutes. Also, social forestry has come up in a very big way. And in the present scenario, almost all our Indian woods find some or the other use in our culture. Then now we have a system of formulating Indian standards. And in those Indian standards, we list most suitable species for that particular purpose. Like if suppose there's a standard on doors and windows, we shall be listing most suitable species recommended for use in doors and windows. And likewise for cooling towers, for wooden sleepers, for railway track, for cross arms, for aircraft construction, for furniture and cabinets, for instrumental industry. So likewise, we have got several Indian standards being formulated, and it is mandatory for all government departments to follow these Indian standards. I've just given details of one of the Indian standards, which has been formulated for doors and window shutters and frames. And this gives classification of timber as per the their superiority. Like this supergroup classifies 11 timber species. So that means these are the most suitable species for shutters. And these, if you have enough money, one should go for the supergroup. Then otherwise, group 1, group 2, and group 3. So likewise, we have this classification, and one has to follow it for making shutters. Likewise, for frames, we have different groups. These are the most suitable ones, then less, and then the still lesser ones. Then bamboo has been in use from the time immemorial in India, and we refer it as cradle to coffin timber. There are 110 species, 22 genera, and there are now a shift of making these modern bamboo houses which have been indigenously developed. And we also have Indian standards, several Indian standards for bamboo. And a lot of work is being carried on out on this particular flora of this particular species. Then lot of uses have been found of the coconut trees, and this is said to be the only tree which made the coastal agrarian settlement possible. The wood has got manifold uses. It is used for rafters, fishing boats, furnitures, doors, windows, panels, decorative items, etc. Then this is my institute. It has got one of the Asia's biggest wooden hall at FRI, which is made up of Tectuna grandis, and the roof is made up of Pinus roxburghii. This is one of the exhibit in one of the museums, and this is 704-year-old wood, and the diameter is 1.4 meters. And you can see the wood of use of wood. This is a 1929 hall, and this is the director's room of FRI, which has got paneling of Calophyllum species, which is very interesting. Calophyllum paneling, and flooring is of Pterocarpus macrocarpus. This is the xylarium of Forest Research Institute. It is one of the best xylarium in the world for tropical woods. And it houses 20,000 wood samples, both from India as well as from various parts of the world. This is our major publication on Indian woods, their identification, properties, and uses, of course. It's a 6-series book and contains most of the information on Indian woods. Now, recently, we have also made a computer software which has got databases on the wood anatomy. It has got images also, that means microstructure images. We have wood properties data on this and also the wood uses data on this particular computer package. Thank you.
Did I hear you right when you said that there was a temple that had Shorya Robusta that had been in the ground and survived for 20 centuries? In ground?
One pillars of Shorya Robusta. I'll just show you once again. Yeah, that is a very important find because that shows the durability of the Shorya Robusta timber. This is the one.
Yeah.
The good state of preservation of the wood which remained in the ground, I'm specifically mentioning here, in the ground for over 20 centuries reflects upon the durability of this timber. This is really strange. Yes.
May I ask you, is any of the site that you identify all the wood over there, is any one of them is non-native species?
Not exactly, no.
Most
of them are indigenous.
Yeah. So even in the port side there, most of the wood is Indian.
Yeah, Indian. I can, but there's one Sweetenia mahogany. Then there's another species of Sweetenia which has come from South America. So there's one record which do says the use of one South American species, yes. And I do not know how it reached to India.
Any more questions?
Very complete introduction of wood culture in India. But in your examples, I've got the impression that most of the wood were used for wood carving, furniture, and So can you give us some of the examples to show how wood is used in construction? At least I've never been to India, but I have the impression that in India you have a lot of construction buildings made of stones, cement. Maybe the wood is not so popular for construction or that sort of things, but can you give the example of how or whether it is popular to use wood for construction?
Yeah, I've shown you so many photographs, like these are all made up of wood. These are the palaces. This is a palace which is in South India. The problem with India is that most of these temples, most of these wooden temples have survived in Northern India. Wherever there was a temperate climate, the temples, they have survived. But in tropical area of India, it was difficult for the wood to survive. So we have very, very few examples from Southern India, and we have got more of stone sculpture in Southern India. But this is a very interesting example, which is again from Kerala, that is South India, the west coast of South India. So that's why specifically I have not brought all the pictures of all the palaces or all the temples. That was not possible. So I've just brought few examples, and this is an interesting one because this comes from the west coast of South India and is still surviving, and this basically dates back to 16th to 18th century. So we have got sufficient examples, but most of the ones which are in good state comes from temperate regions. Yes. This is again teak pillars. This is totally made up of teak. This is still surviving in Bangalore. This is Tipu's palace. Tipu Sultan was there, a very well-known king of South India. And this is his palace, wooden palace, totally made up of wood.
Is the wood is destroyed by the by decay or by the termite? Which one is more damage in the India?
Termite, of course, was there, but it is more of a decay. Yeah.
Any more questions? And then if not, join us to thank again Dr. Cooper for her presentation.